Yes, we're back and looking at the second topic. President Muhammadu Buhari signed the 2021 budget into law some hours ago. The signing of the budget comes exactly 10 days after both chambers of the National Assembly passed the 13.6 trillion naira budget for 2021 and 3 days after it was transmitted to the president for his assent. With the president's approval, the bill becomes law and the implementation is expected to commence in January for 2021 fiscal year. Joining us to discuss this is Mokhtar Mohammed, an economist, a financial analyst, and call him any name you feel like. It's a very popular face on TV. Good evening, Mohammed.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Yeah, I'm excited to
and
see
you. And compliment of the season.
Yeah, same to you. Okay, let's look at what a lot of people will call a quantum leap, you know, getting the budget signed by last day in the year. What does this mean to us or to you or to every other expert?
I think the thing that it means to the government, not to me, and maybe to some experts, is that the government have been able to keep to their January to December deadline without doing due diligence to the budget. That's how I feel. We're rushing because we want to make sure the budget comes into law by January to December without doing really due diligence. That's how I feel personally. I might be wrong, but if you look at the figures and you look at what they are banishing around, we look at the budget critically, you realize that it's a budget that looks like a budget that is meant to fail even from the day of its signing into law, because a lot of parameters are not looking good in that budget.
I will come back to those parameters and you help us break it down within the few minutes we have left. But I'm a bit worried about your comment, because even at the federal level, probably this is the fastest we've seen in terms of the duration in working towards the budget. But this has been a trend in virtually all states of the country. You will always see just normal process, get the budget to the state assembly, they just take it back, almost hook, line, and sinker, and the governor signs it, and this is what the state runs with throughout the year. So where is this culture of due process that we always expect in a federal budget? Where is it coming from?
I think that is why you said in your opening remark, I like what you said, that the budget is supposed to start running by tomorrow. Tomorrow is the 1st of January. So the budget is supposed to start running by tomorrow. But you and I know that budget will not run tomorrow because there's a lot of lapses in that budget. Like you rightly pointed out, I think sometimes we just play to the gallery. Some states can be getting their budget right, and one of those states I think is Lagos State. In terms of implementation, they do implementation up to 70% to 80%. But the federal government, the best implementation they've ever had, they will tell you, is about 50% to 55%, because like one minister once said, money approved is not money released. So once you see, that is the reason why you see that most of these budgets that are passed into the law are not implementable, because most of these budgets are true. I am not surprised where we are today as regard the budget. I'm not going to be surprised if this budget does not do anything like what you see in other states, with the exception from Lagos. I think other states just decide, even with the Lagos too, you realize that it looks good because it's the House, the State House of Assembly is controlled by one party. So even other states that are controlled by one party, they don't seem to do due diligence. They just pass it into law. And we see the type of implementation we see on this state. And that's why we get the kind of result or what we see here from this state. Most times the budget is just meant to pay salaries after salaries. Other projects never see the light of the day.
Yeah, Mokhtar, from time to time when we bring you to talk on this issue, something is always very dominant. That has to do with how much is budgeted for capital expenditure. And maybe because of where I stay, I don't know what is happening in every other state, where you see a whole lot of projects going on. I see some kind of hurry happening this period, especially on Lagos Ibadan Express Road. And my question is, What happened to yet to be released funds in 2020? Are they going to be brought forward and be added to this 2021? And what should we expect in terms of capital? Because if we go into the recurrent, we might just have another headache going into the new year.
Yeah, when you look at the capital expenditure, you see that most of these projects are continuity projects, right, from over 2 to 3 years. So what they do is it's just continuation. Each project, they make a provision for them because they are projects that are going to run for about 2 to 3 years or 4 years, like the Lagos-Ibadan Expressway, the second Niger Bridge, the Mambela Plateau Power Projects. All these projects are continuous projects. So they will run concurrently with the new one because the money has been released in phases. And if you want to follow the law, remember that the law that came to play is that once a new budget is signed into law, the other funds that have not been used should be returned back to the federal government coffers. That's why I say sometimes we tend to say talk with two sides of our mouth, because just before this budget was signed into law today, maybe the members of the House of Rep and the Senate were thinking that the president may not sign this budget into law. They already said that the other budget, the 2020 budget, will run till June. So all of a sudden, the president has signed it into law now. So it becomes law. So what happened to the 2020 budget, especially funds that have been reduced or funds that have not been used or funds that was just released, and here we have the 2021 budget. I think that is not the question for me to answer. I hope the finance minister will give us a full briefing and give us in-depth analysis, and then maybe these questions will begin to come in.
Okay, why we will leave that for the finance minister to help us respond. Let's also look at what a lot of people are interested in. How does this thing translate to their day-to-day? The easiest one was the jobs that were promised in terms of 20,000 just for 3 months. People are yet to come to terms with figures that are convincing. Don't also forget the unfortunate incident about palliatives during the COVID, how a lot of people lost trust in government and how these things will get to them. Leave it or you take it, we are going to be facing the second phase of COVID-19. And this might also come with some kind of attendant lockdown. Does this budget put this into perspective?
Definitely no. It is a budget that put this into perspective. We won't be having the House of Rep increasing all this. They both chambers, it's not only the House of Rep, increasing the budget by 550 billion and telling us that because oil price has gone up to $50 per barrel, knowing that we have the second wave, and even if most economy in the world are not practically wanting to shut down at the moment. But definitely, like you said, it may come to a time whereby we will see those shutdowns. I pray we don't get to that level where we see those shutdowns. So if you ask me whether does this budget take into consideration most of this point that you have raised, I don't think so. This budget is just a budget that was based on last year. Nobody think of the pandemic. Oil price at $40 per barrel, I was one of those people that was thinking it's not realistic. And here we are, we have oil price at $50 per barrel, and our legislators have increased the budget by $550 billion, and they are telling the president to send a supplementary bill. A budget that is already running off a deficit of 5 something trillion, and yet we are still increasing it because we need projects to go to our constitution. A budget that is still faulty in the sense that we have the oil benchmark at 397, and we have the CBN rate at 390. We have the oil benchmark at 378, and we have the CBN rate at 391. And up just this, just today, in the I&E window, we have seen that rate jump to 410. And when you see rate gets to 410 in the I&E window, that is a pointer to what the CBN will be thinking of. That means tactically, we may have seen another devaluation of the currency. And when you see that now, if you target at 379 and we are doing 391, What that said, that means there's a deficit also in that budget again that is not being captured. And most ones of those deficits also will come in the area of loans and loans that we've collected, because mostly foreign loans. So what happens is that those foreign loans, if they were doing it at 3.79, it's now 3.91 and it's now 410. So that has increased. So where do you have the money for the capital expenditure? So those are just little things that you can see in the budget and makes you feel that this budget is bound to fail even before it starts.
Wow, Mokhtar, I wish you would give us some kind of hope on this budget, but your language is not mistaken in any way. Thank you once again, Mokhtar Mohammed, on your analysis of the 2021 budget, which was signed into law today by President Muhammadu Buhari. Once again, thank you.
It's always a pleasure. Once again, Happy New Year. See you in 2021.
I'll see you soon, too. And this is where we call it a wrap on today's edition of Plus Politics. Plus Politics returns tomorrow, where we'll have a New Year edition of what we are expecting in the political landscape. Join us again. I am Kayode Ladeindi, saying bye for now.